follows an extract from my book Fête Fatale, available from Amazon. Chapter 10, Part 1. Early the next morning, Beth jumped out of bed with a new sense of purpose. After mulling the situation over through the night, she decided to take action. Sitting at the breakfast table, she stirred her cool, lumpy porridge and chatted to Drew. "The boys have decided to stay over for the day, as they are both free today. Would you mind if I ask Nathaniel to join you all with Primrose so that I can whisk Emma off for a few hours? Primrose will have a lovely morning, soaking up loads of positive male reinforcement, and she knows that she gets spoilt when the men are in charge. If Nathaniel has plans for the day, would you look after Rose yourself?" "That's fine by me. It'd be nice if Nathaniel could join us. We can have a movie session. If he's busy, I'm sure we'll manage for a few hours without any female intervention. Noodle will help keep Primrose occupied, won't you, buddy?" said Drew, glancing towards the dog. A sleepy nose peered at Drew in response to hearing his name, which Drew interpreted as canine agreement. "See, he can still take on a four-year-old girl. What are you planning on doing?" "I'd like to muster a girly trip to the Blue Willow Tea Rooms. I haven't been for ages and I think Eileen is doing a super job there." "It must be really hard work." "If there are enough of you on duty, how do you feel about having young Toby join in? Henrietta doesn't get many treats and I particularly want her to join in if she can. I'm really pleased at the way she's getting along with Emma. It's good to see the friendship growing." "I should think that would be okay. Toby and Rose play nicely together and I'm sure that Toby would enjoy hanging around with the guys for the day. I'll hold the fort if the others are busy. I'm sure it'll be fine. I expect that we'll end up with a house full. What shall I feed them all on?" "I'll ring around and see who's up for a party. When I've an idea of numbers, I'll get some naan bread pizzas ready for you to shove in the oven when you're ready. They'll only take about 4 minutes, so they'll be easy enough." Beth made her round of calls and it was arranged that all the men and children would meet at the house and the ladies would meet at the Blue Willow Tea Rooms. Beth also decided to invite May to join in her underlying scheme, but before she could scroll down the phone's contact list, the handset rang as she held it. The caller ID displayed Benji's name. "Hello Benji, how nice to hear from you again so soon." "Hi, not only am I a regular caller, I'm going to be a regular visitor. I need to speak to young Maddox and rather than discuss things over the phone, I've cleared my desk and I'm driving over to speak to him in person. I thought I'd come and see you guys as soon as I'm done." "How lovely. I hope we'll be seeing a bit more of you if you're working with Maddox. It's going to be quite a gathering. The boys are here and Nathaniel is coming over too. I think they're planning on watching movies. I'm nipping out for an hour or two, but I'm sure I'll catch you before you go back. Is it anything particular that's bringing you to our fair village?" "I want to speak to Maddox to see how he got on at the Jeffersons'. I don't think I mentioned it to you when you were here last, but Drew knows Jefferson. He does artwork for his company from time to time." "Does he now? I'll be grilling Drew too." "How terrifying. It's a small world, isn't it? The concentric circles of life have a knack of overlapping in the strangest places. Give my love to Lexi. You must bring her with you one time." "I will. I'll see if I can tear her away from the city." Having arranged the rendezvous at the Blue Willow Tea Rooms, Beth set quickly to work in preparing food for the male entourage, laying out packet naan breads over the entire work surface of the kitchen. She spread a blend of passata and tomato puree over each slice and then sprinkled dried mixed herbs over the tomato base. This was then topped with grated cheese and slices of pepperoni. Glancing at the clock, Beth figured that it wasn't worth trying to store them in the fridge. They wouldn't have fitted anyway. Chances were that the lunch would be early that day. To bolster the meal, Beth then opened two packs of part-baked baguettes and sliced them at an angle into small chunks. In the fridge was a stock of homemade garlic butter, which she always made sure was to hand, and this was quickly loaded between the chunks of bread to follow the pizzas into the oven. Kissing Drew goodbye, she headed towards Main Street in the centre of Mossleigh Village. It boasted a post office, which also doubled as a minor grocery store, a pet and animal food store, and Nicholas Florist's shop. It also housed the Blue Willow Tea Rooms. All of the buildings lay on the left-hand side of the road as you walk towards Main Street from Beth's house. On the right-hand side was a grassy expanse which gave way to a small natural lake. There weren't enough resident attractions to make Mossleigh into a tourist spot, but cars driving through often chose it as a place to break their journey and visit the tea rooms or picnic by the lake. The interior of the Blue Willow didn't hold any surprises. The main theme of the decor, along with its
for
title,
the full book of Fête Fatale, available in paperback or as an ebook, follow the link in the cards in the description box,
just over
or
the
find details on my website at
sharonbill.com. Thanks for listening. All about the room and the colourway of the tablecloths and curtains maintained thematic unity. The school summer holidays often brought a lot of passing trade, and the little room was quite full. Beth entered through the door in the centre of two large windows and scanned the tables for either a vacant table or one occupied with her chosen party. Towards the back of the room, a raised arm gesticulated and was followed by the emerging head of May, who beckoned Beth to join them. Dealing first with the matter of primary importance, they selected sandwiches and tea to aid negotiations, and then the group looked at Beth expectantly. "Although it's very nice to meet you for tea and sandwiches, and we're happy to do so whenever you summon us, Emma seems to think that you have something up your sleeve. Is this a cloak and dagger rendezvous? Do we need a secret handshake before you'll tell us all?" said May. "I'm so glad that you could all make it. Henrietta, I'm pleased that you've joined in our little conspiracy," said Beth. The explanation was delayed by the arrival of an old country willow tiered stand holding a stack of sandwiches and a huge old country willow teapot with all the necessary accoutrements. It was unanimously agreed that under the circumstances it was necessary to both speak and eat, and so talking with your mouth full was voted in as an acceptable behaviour for their newly formed league. Duly reassured, Beth bit into a salmon and cucumber sandwich and said, "What I really want is to conscript your services." After listening to what is being said about John Barlow's death, I gather that the officials aren't entirely satisfied, but at present can offer no suitable explanation. I know that Benji and Bobby Maddox are pursuing what inquiries they can with vigour, and I expect that Bobby is keen to show his worth to Winsford HQ. The problem there is that they are bound by what I think of as the official perspective. Benji always tells me that he suffers from people unwittingly keeping information back purely because they give stifled official answers. He says that they are only too aware that they are answering a policeman's questions and don't like to feel that they are gossiping. The problem is that relaxed gossip is just what he needs. That's where the little gems of information are to be found. People don't mean to hold back any important facts. It's just that you don't know what is or isn't important straight away. I read a book years ago called A Jury of Her Peers, where the women of a small village solve the motive for a murder by looking into a sewing box and understanding the significance of unfinished kitchen chores. A woman's plight of loneliness was explained by the fact that she had to knot her quilting rather than sewing it in the usual way in a quilting bee. I appreciate that this is a melodramatic example, but the point remains. All of us here are in just the right place to casually snoop around and pick up bits and bobs of important information in passing. It's so much more revealing when you're on the domestic level, don't you think? Said Beth. You mean that you get more inside people's lives when you see inside their kitchen cupboards, rather than just what you'd get shown as a visitor, said Emma. That's precisely my point. Just like the women in the story could peep inside a sewing box, we can peep around as opportunity provides, and we just need to be aware and ready to take notice, said Beth. What exactly is it that you think we'd be looking for? I'm not saying that I will just yet, but if I did agree, what do you hope for us to find? Said Henrietta. As cleaning lady at the home of the Barlows, there was no doubt that this was directed particularly to her. Are you suggesting that John was murdered if you're referring to your story? I'm not suggesting that particularly, but nobody can easily explain why he died so suddenly. I realise that this might sound a little far-fetched, but we all know that John was more than usually worried recently, and I do have a concern that it's possible that he may have committed suicide, said Beth. Oh no, I'd never even considered that. Now that you put it that way, I understand you wanting to snoop a bit, said May. Do you see my concern? Asked Beth. I don't want to raise any official alarm until we feel that it's justified, but we can perhaps exert ourselves to find out if there is sufficient grounds for raising any alarm. I know that Benji will be bearing such a circumstance in mind. He's bound to. However, he can only get official information. He can't go rummaging in cupboards without a search warrant, but it's hardly conducive to gossip when you've been served a warrant, is it? We can find out a lot, quite unofficially, by paying a bit more attention and maybe contriving a few schemes. Henrietta is in the perfect position as cleaner, and especially as she helps Jean clear out John's things. You can tell an awful lot about a person by cleaning out their bathroom cabinet and sock drawer. Surely John wouldn't consider such a thing, said Henrietta. I hadn't known John for very long, but I'd never have thought him capable of such a thing. There's no point saying that, though, is there? Said Beth. I'm sure that all the friends and relatives of suicide victims would say the same. If we're wrong, then we've lost nothing and nobody is any the wiser. Nobody is unduly upset. If we're right, well, we've helped speed the process along and we'll hand it all over to Benji to deal with properly. I'm not suggesting that we undermine the official process, but I do suggest that we have unique insight and access that would help the official procedure if it came to that. We can look inside the proverbial sewing box without raising suspicion or alarm. If you agree in principle, then we can make a more guided plan of how to work together. Do you agree that it's a valid suggestion? For the full book of Fête Fatale, available in paperback or as an ebook, follow the link in the cards in the description box or find details on my website at sharonbill.com. Thanks for listening.